We now know for the first time who in the FBI was alerted that Christopher Steele, 10 days before the FISA warrant against Donald Trump's campaign was secured, was alerted that Christopher Steele had gone to the State Department and kind of blabbed about what he was doing with the FBI, which is a violation of his confidentiality.
As an FBI asset, so he's an informant to the FBI.
He's an informant.
Shouldn't be talking to other agencies about being an informant. Shouldn't be talking to the press. He blabs, unloads the state. State realizes this is nutty and decides to tell the FBI. Who do they talk to at the FBI, John?
Well, they went to an FBI supervisor. His name is Stephen Laycock. At the time, he was a unit chief or section chief in counterintelligence for Eurasia matters, so right in the Russia realm. And he immediately takes the information from State, the alert that, hey, Christopher Steele just showed up here and blabbed around, and he forwards it on to the team leading the Russia investigation, which, of course, is Pete Stroke. That is an important piece of
new information. Hang on. So we know this is a fact, that this information... Go ahead.
Yep, the government officials are familiar. First, I have the email, so we know the email went. I was able to identify his name and the flow of the information through reporting multiple sources. But Laycock gets it within 2 days of the meeting, so still 8 days before the FISA, and he forwards it on to the Russia team that's headed by Pete Stroke.
Wow.
Now, that is significant.
That's massive.
Very significant.
That's massive. So they had been warned by another agency, and 8 days later, they still apply for the first FISA warrant.
Yep, that is the key thing, and we don't see any evidence of tapping the brakes. But let me tell you what people who used to work in the FBI and held very senior jobs. I talked to the person who used to hold Stephen Laycock's current job. So Laycock's been promoted since then. He's now the intelligence chief for the FBI, assistant director of intelligence, very high up, right under Chris Wray.
Mm-hmm.
One of his predecessors, Kevin Brock, says, the way the FBI is supposed to work in a normal case is when you hear an informant has gone elsewhere and started to talk, you tap your brakes, you stop, you start to reevaluate, and you find out everything you can. What was he doing at this other location? What was he saying to you? What was his motivation for going to you? And you reevaluate his credibility, his reliability, before you proceed in using him further in an investigation. There's no evidence that happened. If it had happened, here's what the FBI would have found sitting in the State Department in its notes and in its files. Christopher Steele admitted he was leaking to the Washington Post and New York Times. Christopher Steele admitted his client was essentially the Democratic National Committee because he called it an institution recently hacked by Russia. Three, Christopher Steele admitted that he had an election day deadline. His client needed to get his FBI intelligence, quote unquote, out to the public before election day. So he had a partisan motive. And four, he was found by the State Department to be not credible on some information. Why is it? He actually is part of spinning his tale of intelligence about this collusion between Russia and Trump, now disproven by Mueller. He alleged that the Russians were paying some of the perpetrators out of the Russian consulate in Miami. The State Department instantly said, wait a second, there is no consulate in Miami, and they flagged that in the notes. Had the FBI taken the time to go find out what Christopher Steele was doing at State, they would have received all of that derogatory information, all of that information calling into question his credibility. We have no evidence they did, though it needs to be investigated. No matter what, we know they went to the court 8 days later and swore under oath that Steele was credible, reliable, and they possessed no derogatory information about him. Pretty extraordinary.
And it's not as if there's another massive pile of actually verified intelligence that was used to justify the FISA warrant. It was predominantly this opposition research file written by an MI6 former agent who hated the president. That was how they got the file, correct, John? The warrant.
That's right, And remember, paid by Hillary Clinton and the Democratic National Committee. He's on their payroll as an opposition researcher. Really remarkable. And so when you look back now, what can we say without doubt? An unreliable informant's information paid by the opponent of Donald Trump was used as the primary justification to spy on the Trump campaign. And 2.5 years later, we now know that evidence amounted to nothing. There was no collusion. It was bad intelligence, and we all, I think, suffered for 2.5 years through a scandal that really wasn't.
Could there be legal consequences, do you think, for Christopher Steele? I mean, he was in breach of his relationship with the FBI, wasn't he?
That was, and eventually he was fired November 1st, which was after the, this is very interesting, they fire him for leaking to the press November 1st, even though the State Department figured out he was leaking before that time. So they wait to after the first FISA warrant is secured using his information to terminate him. But then they do a strange thing. They continue to draw information from him through a cutout. They use Bruce Orr, the Justice Department official, whose wife works for, with Steele at the same Fusion GPS firm, and Bruce Orr becomes a backdoor for continuing to suck information out of Christopher Steele and getting it to the FBI. It's a remarkable story of even creating the appearance he was fired, but then still benefiting from his information.
I'm going to
very unusual circumstance.
I'm going to use a very technical term here. I've learned it after more than 20 years in the national security domain. This whole thing stinks, John Solomon.
Yeah,
it stinks
right
to high heaven. We are talking to John Solomon. He may not be Steve Garrett, but he might as well be. His name is John Solomon, Executive Vice President of Hilton. You know what we're talking about, right, John? You're old enough.
I do. I'm a Hawaii 5-0 junkie, both generations.
Good man. Book 'em, Dano. We are back, and we are talking skullduggery. That's a good word. I don't use that often enough.
It is.
Skullduggery in the swamp that is Washington. Big news this week, massive news. We don't know how long U.S. Attorney John Durham has been on the case. Some people say, oh, he was just appointed this week by Barr. Others have said, oh, no, he's been investigating skullduggery for weeks. John, is this a big deal? And what should we expect next from this new setup, this new team at Maine DOJ?
Yeah, it is a big development. First off, you have a prosecutor with a remarkable reputation of getting into some of the most difficult issues of the FBI, things like the Whitey Bulger scandal, sticking to the facts and coming to the proper resolution for the American public. He's considered nonpartisan, tough as nails, but doesn't bloviate things and try to call something that it isn't. He's a straight shooter, and I think that that's going to be a good thing here, because at the end of the day, what we need to do is fix the intelligence community so these temptations and these failures of the Russia probe don't repeat themselves. And he's the right guy for the right job at the right time in our history.
He looks like a mean, mean man. but question, has he put any bent cops in prison, John Solomon? Do we know what results he has brought in his almost 40 years in service?
He has. He's brought several corruption cases, including against a former governor in Connecticut, and also brought several matters against FBI agents that were related to the Whitey Bulger case. So he has a record of enforcing the law, even in tough circumstances. And remember, the FBI did not want to talk about the Whitey Bulger scandal for a long time.
Right.
He was able to extract the truth from that, and I think that is to one of his credits. And I think people across the political spectrum respect him for his record and his sort of his bipartisan approach or nonpartisan approach to prosecution, which is what you need in this.
So what do you expect?
Too much politics in the beginning of this case.
Oh my gosh, it was all politics. So what does John Solomon expect in the next, I don't know, 6 to 12 months?
Well, keep in mind that one of the important things that a prosecutor can bring to the table is grand jury subpoenas. So IG can only do so much. If a former employee of the Justice Department doesn't want to voluntarily cooperate with the IG, they don't have to. A grand jury subpoena solves that problem. So there's a new investigative tool to compel testimony, compel production of documents if there's any criminality suspected. I think that's a very important part. I think another important part is you hear that Barr has invited in the CIA director, FBI director. Now, FBI director makes a lot of sense. CIA director raises the question, did the CIA have a role in this whole mess? They've been kind of quiet, right? Very important development. Let's see what that brings and what Gina Haspel brings to the table in terms of revelations. And then I think there's something that the president himself can do while this investigation is going on. With these documents at state, we have more questions than we have answers, right? There are a series of documents the president could declassify tomorrow that would significantly enhance the public's understanding of what went on. And I'm going to give you three that I think are essential.
Okay, hang on. Let's make sure. So these are the three documents the president of the United States needs to declassify. I just want to be clear here. Okay, go ahead, John Solomon.
This is my favorite list. All
okay,
right.
Good.
Number three, I think it's a bucket that Devin Nunes calls bucket four, so I don't want to confuse you on numbers. But it's a group of emails, a string of emails from the FBI from October, where the FBI is debating about Steele's credibility. It shows the FBI may have had some concern about Steele before they offered him to the court. And I think that, getting that out, particularly in light of the State Department's information, essential. Number two, there's a set of documents that we call the exculpatory statements. It's a record of statements that were intercepted or gathered by informants or FBI agents against targets like Carter Page and George Papadopoulos, where instead of admitting to guilt or proving their involved in collusion, in fact, weighed in on their innocence and exculpated them from what the theory was. Basically undercut the predicate of the investigation. We should get those released. And then Bruce Orr's famous 302 reports with Devin Nunez and Chuck Grassley have been calling for a long time. Let's get those released because he's that secret conduit for a long time that continues to feed the FBI with Steele's bad intelligence. And I think those three things will help us understand in greater detail what was going on in mid-October and why the State Department visit may be one of the most important meetings we did not know about until recently.
Mr. President, you have your list. John, you should work in the White House. I'm Sebastian Gorka. He is John Solomon, Executive Vice President.